the emperor had once more to fight against the allied armies, increased by the entire force of Austria. Whilst before the intervention of this power, peace would have been concluded. Austria's partiality at the Congress of Prague, which would be better described by the name of treachery, the refusal to admit the free discussion of concessions, which were certainly worthy of debate, the cold and insulting rupture of the negotiations, which left no door open to pacification, convinced Napoleon that he had no other alternative than to conquer or to die, or to abdicate if the nation abandoned him. Later on, Napoleon abdicated under circumstances where the welfare of France seemed to render such a step necessary. But that was not the case at that time, and the emperor did not consider himself at liberty to surrender to foreigners provinces which composed the integrity of the territory which had been confided by the French nation to his keeping. With what applause would not his contemporaries and many of his traducers themselves have hailed him? What blessings would have been reserved for his memory had he only been successful? The fatal news of Austria's desertion deeply affected the Empress Marie Louise. She feared that it might result in a diminution of the emperor's affection for her, but he did not cease to give her proofs of his confidence. She, on her side, tried to inspire her husband with the trust she had in her father's probity and offered, prompted by a feeling which may be styled French, to act as peacemaker between them. Marie Louise had indeed at that time so entirely assumed French habits that in her letters to her father, which were written in German, she was often forced to make use of French expressions, having forgotten the German equivalents. It is known that up to August 30th, 1813, the French army won victories which revived hopes which had been weakened by Austria's desertion. The Empress shared in the general satisfaction created in our country by this good news. She did me the honor of writing to me from Cherbourg on August 31st, on the occasion of the victory at Dresden on the 27th. This is her letter. My health would be good enough, but for a bad cold on the chest, which tires me greatly, I shall, however, do nothing to cure it until I get back to Paris. Besides, the good news which I have received today will do me much more good than all the drugs imaginable. I hope that this great victory will soon bring back the emperor and peace with him. Another letter dated from Rouen, September 2nd, Marie Louise, having stopped in that town on her way back to Paris, ran as follows. You must be very pleased with all the particulars of the splendid victory which the emperor has just won. What pleases me most is to know that he did not expose himself. God grant that it may bring us peace. I want it badly, as do all persons who are devoted to the emperor. The desertion of Austria, which had added to the forces of the Allies 200,000 men, seemed to forebode that fresh enemies would rise up against us, and Napoleon had been obliged to prepare himself to meet this new situation. Already on the 16th of August, he had set out from Dresden, after having confided to the corps of Marshal Saint-Cyr the defense of this central point. Having traveled into Silesia in order to reconnoiter the Prussian army, which he defeated in several engagements, the emperor then returned against the great Austrian army, which had just entered Saxony. Deceived by the departure of Napoleon, whom they believed to be in Silesia, the Austrians wished to profit by his absence to take possession of Dresden and crush the corps of Marshal Saint-Cyr. But Napoleon, wishing above all to save Dresden, returned rapidly to the capital of Saxony, which was menaced by the great army of the Allies. He arrived there on the 26th August in the morning, followed by the corps of Marshal Ney. The town was already surrounded by immense forces before which the feeble corps of Marshal Saint-Cyr was bound to succumb. The unlooked-for arrival of Napoleon restored confidence already in several German corps allied to the French and reassured the king and his family, who were preparing for flight. The people hailed him as a liberator. The emperor's plans were quickly made. In the night of the 26th to the 27th August, the Austro-Russian army, which was commanded by Prince Schwarzenberg, gave the signal for the attack. And general and terrible battle ensued. Napoleon had some officers killed and wounded at his side, the strife only ceasing at 9 o'clock at night. The Allies lost 30,000 men killed, wounded, or prisoners, a part of their artillery and an enormous quantity of equipages, stragglers, and convoys of wounded. The French General Moreau returned from America at the instigation of Bernadotte to aid the Emperor of Russia in his councils, assisted at this battle. Injured by a mortal wound, which necessitated the amputation of both legs, he expired the following day. Such was the sad end of a Frenchman, crowned with a splendid military aureole, whom death seized upon in the midst of the enemy's ranks whilst committing a flagrant crime against his country. The Emperor of Russia had the body of General Moreau buried in the Catholic Church of St. Petersburg. He addressed a letter of condolence to his widow, presented her with 500,000 rubles, and conferred upon her a pension of 30,000 rubles. The emperor had assuredly the right to render these honors to the memory of Moreau, and to accord these favors to the family of that general, which was quite willing to accept them. But what is to be said of the King of France, Louis XVIII? Who, after his restoration, conferred on Madame Moreau the marshal's staff, which he had intended for the husband of this lady, and further conferred on her the honors and prerogatives which the wives and widows of the marshals enjoyed. What is to be said of the proposition made on the 26th April, 1814, to the Senate by one of its members and supported by several of his colleagues, a proposition which had for its object to declare that General Moreau had merited public esteem and the gratitude of his country, of the religious service ordered on the 23rd June of the same year in the Church of St. Paul at Paris, and the approbation, and at the expense of the king, for Pichegru, George, and Moreau, and for the 11 assassins who had perished with George, of the royal decree of the 27th February, 1815, which decreed the erection of statues to Moreau and Pichegru. Public opinion revolted against such an interpretation of national honor. It would not allow the crimes committed against the country to the profit of a single family to be glorified. The ennoblement of the family of George Cadoudal was tolerated, but public honors rendered to these turncoats who carried arms against France were the fruit of an unhallowed policy, insulting and humiliating to the great mass of the nation. After the letter which informed the empress of the result of the great battle of Dresden, this princess remained 8 days without any news of the emperor. She was good enough to send me the following letter very early in the morning of September 11th at St. Cloud. I sent you a letter from the emperor, which I received very late yesterday, just a minute after I had left the empress. I think you will be glad to read it because you share my anxiety. As soon as you have read it, be so good as to send it back. The glorious victory of Dresden was dearly paid for by the succession of reverses which followed, by the defeat which Oudinot, Duke of Reggio, met with at Grosbeeren, by the disaster which the Duke of Tarent MacDonald met with at Katzbach, and by the loss of the Battle of Dinowitz, where Marshal Ney was commanding. At Grosbeeren and at Dinowitz, Bernadotte had the questionable honor of defeating French soldiers commanded by two of his oldest comrades in arms. The reverse which proved most fatal to us was a defeat at Kulm, where General Vandamme, who had remained behind with a corps of 30,000 men in consequence of some misunderstanding, which has never been explained, lost half his troops, 60 pieces of cannon, and fell into the hands of the enemy with General Hexo. Shamefully treated by an ungenerous enemy, the French general was made the butt of the insults of the Russian and Prussian people and soldiers. General Corbineau was fortunate enough to force his way with a corps of cavalry which he commanded, and with 12,000 infantry soldiers who were following him, and to be able to come up with the army. General Vandamme's false maneuver, on which the success of the campaign was to depend, had a powerful influence on the unhappy issue of events. Unfortunately, Napoleon had not the gift of ubiquity, and fortune was withdrawing little by little from him, whom she had so often favored. The sudden illness with which Napoleon was stricken after the victory of Dresden may also be looked upon as the effect of fatality. Just as he was about to enter Pirna in pursuit of the enemy, a passing but violent indisposition, which had probably been caused by the quantity of rain to which he had been exposed, seized suddenly upon Napoleon, whose frequent vomiting gave rise to the fear that he might have been poisoned. This great soul, an emanation from a divine source, yielded to this moment of enfeeblement of his mortal coil, and the emperor had to be brought back at full speed to Dresden in a state of absolute mental and physical prostration. The Allied army was at that time in such a state of confusion that it has been admitted by the enemies themselves that it had been vigorously pursued, it would infallibly have been destroyed. This fatal incident saved it, and all hope of winning peace disappeared. The series of our misfortunes dates from this day. Misfortunes which were hurried on by the disaster of the days at Leipzig, which brought about the successive desertion of Bavaria, Württemberg, and the Confederate States of the Rhine. Another desertion, if I may use such an expression, which must greatly have affected the emperor, was the spirit of hidden opposition, which was to be noticed in several generals of the French army. This inclination to rebel, which was but poorly dissimulated, dated back from the time of our disasters during the Russian campaign. It developed into more definite resistance when Napoleon announced his bold plan of leaving the road of the Rhine open to the Allied troops maneuvering on their rear, threatening Potsdam and Berlin, which the enemies were leaving unprotected, and of raising the siege of the various fortresses in which we had left garrisons, a maneuver of the same kind which had been successfully carried out by the great Frederick in the Seven Years' War, promised a good result. Seeing that he would be badly seconded, Napoleon hesitated. Moreover, news of the various adhesions to the coalition obliged him to abandon this plan. The positive assurance of the fidelity to the French alliance, which had only shortly before had been given by the King of Bavaria and his minister to the Emperor, had made him hope that this desertion would only take place later on. I have heard Napoleon complain bitterly of this conduct at a sitting of the Council of State. The King of Bavaria, who was well-intentioned, but an easy prince, who had been dragged away by the rapidity of the events and by the persuasion of a faction which had its head, General Vreda, who had been loaded with kindnesses by the emperor. On September 27th, Napoleon addressed the following letter to the Empress Regent. "Madame and dear friend, you will go and preside at the Senate and will make the following speech. The Minister of War will make a report and the orators of the Council of State will present a synod consultum for the levy of the conscription. You will go in a gala carriage with all suitable pomp, as is the custom when I go to the legislative body. Signed, Napoleon, Dresden, September 27th, 1813. P.S. As this speech had to be written in cipher, Duke de Bassano will have it translated and will send it to the Arch-Chancellor, who will hand it to you. The speech referred to is the one which was published in the Moniteur of October 8th. The Senatus Consultum ordered the levy of 208,000 conscripts, 120,000 of which were to be taken from the soldiers whose service was to begin in 1814 and earlier, and 160,000 of the year 1815. This anticipation of the conscription of 2 years, which was not a reassuring sign, filled the Empress with sad thoughts. She was anxious about the future. The part which she was to play at the Senate also frightened her by its novelty. However, her youth, ability, and the modesty of her attitude produced an impression upon the senators. Monsieur de Talleyrand said in the evening, as he was going to the theatrical performance at the court, that she had been neither bold nor timid, and that she had shown dignity combined with much tact and propriety. The reverses which followed on the victory of Dresden and Bavaria's desertion having put it out of the emperor's power to maneuver, at least between the Elbe and the Oder, had decided to precede the enemy to Leipzig, where Prince Schwarzenberg's army was also marching. On October 7th, Napoleon left Dresden, which till then had been the center of his operations, leaving Marshal Saint-Cyr with an army of 25,000 men in the city. and garrisons in the forts of Magdeburg, Wittenberg, and Torgau. The emperor arrived at Leipzig on October 15th, where he was joined by the king and queen of Saxony. On the morrow of his arrival, the Allied armies attacked the French army at Wachau. They were defeated and lost 20,000 men. Poniatowski won his marshal's baton there, but what was such a loss, however great it may appear, to an enemy which was constantly replacing its tired and defeated soldiers with fresh troops? The Austrian general Meerfeldt, who was taken prisoner in this battle, was sent by Napoleon to the Emperor of Austria with pacific proposals, which were coldly received by the Allies. The enemies renewed the attack on the morrow. In spite of their extreme inferiority in point of numbers, the French troops sustained the fight, thanks to their heroic efforts, with advantage, but for the impossibility of turning or breaking into an impenetrable line formed of an accumulation of 300,000 hostile troops protected by more than 1,000 cannon, the desertion of the Saxons and the Württembergers made the scale in which the destinies of France and Europe were being weighed in the balance turn in the favor of the Allies. All military writers have recorded the disasters which marked this bloody day and morrow. I cannot, however, refrain from speaking after them of the shameful incident which marked the day of the morning, Negro Notanda Lapio, the desertion to the enemy of an Allied army corps, which took place on the field of battle itself in the heat of the fight, an occurrence unheard of in the history of modern war, in one of those critical moments when everybody rushes to the spot where there is the greatest danger. The Saxons, feigning to follow the general movement, advanced upon the enemies, but to join it. It was seen with stupor that the ranks of a foreign army commanded by a Frenchman, Bernadotte, opened to receive our faithless allies, marching under a flag stained with the vilest treachery. Needed to be added, alas, that this Frenchman threatened the general commanding the Saxons with branding, because with some last traces of decency, the latter hesitated to turn against our troops, the cannon, which a moment before had been fired in their defense. The exhaustion of the army and the want of ammunition rendering a fresh battle impossible, the emperor decided to retreat. He returned to Leipzig to take leave of the king and queen of Saxony, who begged him to withdraw, lest to so many disasters should be added his capture by the enemy, adjuring him to leave them to their sorrowful fate. Napoleon, moved to tears and kept back by his gratitude for such great devotion, hesitated about separating from them. In the meanwhile, the danger of being surrounded by the enemy becoming imminent, the emperor yielded to the pressing entreaties of his faithful and venerable allies. He bade them farewell and embracing them, assuring them that one day France would discharge her debts towards them, whatever might be the fate to which Providence destined him personally. The calamities which accompanied the retreat of the army after the battle at Leipzig, the untimely breaking down of the Elster Bridge, which resulted in the capture of several divisions, and the death of the brave Poniatowski in this river are well-known matters. The Allies, having entered the city of Leipzig, seized upon the King of Saxony and sent him under escort to Berlin to expiate the crime of his inviolable fidelity to France. Napoleon fell back on Erfurt with the remnants of his army. The king of Naples took leave of the emperor there, not without emotion on both sides, for each felt that it was their last farewell. The insinuations which the Austrians had made to King Joachim at his outposts had, it must said, been listened to with more attention by him than by the venerable king of Saxony. Our army's retreat was effected with fairly good fortune in spite of the numerous partisans who harassed our troops during their march. However, near Hanau, 60,000 Bavarians and Austrians undertook to bar the way to the French army. General Vreda commanded them. In the ardor of his zeal, for the new cause, which he had embraced the day before. This general, formerly so proud, as he used to say, of the esteem of the first hero of the century, and of the endowment of 30,000 francs a year, which he had received from him, thought to have little difficulty in disposing of a vanquished and retreating army. Success did not justify these ungrateful and culpable hopes. The lion, although sorely wounded, was not yet dead. The victory of the Battle of Hanau opened the road back to its frontiers to the French army. The Austro-Bavarians lost more than 10,000 men in this murderous encounter. General Vreta was dangerously wounded there, and his son-in-law, Prince Duttingen, lost his life.